Hello everyone, my name is Pasi Fränti and this talk is about keyword extraction from web pages. It is based on the paper mentioned below. Some web pages can be extremely simple, like Google web pages, but most of the web pages are much more complex. There are the relevant information, text, there might be also images, the title, keywords might be mentioned somewhere, and navigational bar and other elements. And the task is to make a summarization of web page with title, some selected image, some description of opening hours or contact information, but the keywords is the one that we are interested in this presentation. Okay, let's say this simple example from Wikipedia, it's just a part of the entire page. What we can see is a Moomin troll, Moomin Peikko. It's a children character from children books. And in this text, you can actually see four places, the red circles where this Moomin Peikko is mentioned in the text, except only one of them is in its actual exact form, while the others are in genetic form, which is very common in Finnish language, but also other languages. Another keyword must be Tove Jansson, the author, or just her first name, Tove. So, in general, the extraction is just a special case of a more general annotation problem, that what are the best keywords to describe the content, while we focus only those words that we can actually find on the web page. A little bit simplified problem. Another simplification is that we only consider single words, while in many cases a better keyword would be actually key phrase, combination of compounded words, like New York is if you consider separately New and York, they have different meaning, but if you put together New York is a city. Same formula is a mathematical concept, one is a number, but put them together, formula one is a racing series. So anyway, the methods what we described here, they are expected to generalize rather straightforward way also to the key phrases. Okay, so let's continue. So what makes the web pages so special or challenging? First, there are no standard structure besides the HTML code itself. The author of the page can use all of his creativity to make what kind of pages you have. Different styles, different layout. It may contain multiple different topics on the same page, even different languages. In this example, you can see there are actually four different languages on the same page, just on the front page. English, Sindhi, Urdu and Arabic, all you can find. So it's also language dependent, so different language, we might need different rules. We might want to know the meaning of the words. And while natural language processing tools, NLP tools exist, they might be time consuming and they also rely on the libraries of the given languages, which might not be always available. Okay, so with these limitations in mind, let's see how our approach now works with. Okay, this is the overall structure and there are two different parts. So the input is the web page and output is the keywords. And two different parts, one we analyze first the context content of the web page and try to extract the one that goes to the DOM tree to the left side and there try to find some candidate words that might be suitable for keywords. And then we try to analyze the properties on the web page to find out which word is important and which not. So we try to give some score for the different words and then select the best. In our case, we simply select the top 10, the 10 most highest scored keywords. And how the scoring is done is based on the structural features, linguistic and statistical features. We characterize to three different classes of all of this. Okay, let's study them a little bit more in detail. First, before we do any of this analysis, we need to do a little bit cleaning of the content. First typical operation is to get rid of the numbers, punctuation marks, and other symbols, and retain only the alphabetic symbols, A, B, C, and so on. Then, the words may have different forms, so to simplify this, either stemming or lemmatization might be applied. They have similar goal to find the root of the word, but a little bit different, so that stemming will find out like a student studies. They all come from the single root study, but this doesn't actually mean any natural word, but it's a common root of those. While lemmatization finds out the words, one of the words that is used and represent the group of words, in this case study. So we can see also that the stemming is more general and might be more useful for keyword extraction, but we can't use all the stems as such because they are not natural words. So in that sense, lemmatization might be more useful, or we could simply find from the stem the one of the real word that is most closest to the stem. So there are different approaches, but these are typically used as pre-processing step. Also, in many languages, there are common words like English, we have a T and for is was. And these are common for every document. So it's one simple approach is to clean them away, filter them out from the document before we start to process them further. Okay, and these are quite effective. Okay, after the process, we need to extract the candidate words. And this is already quite simple. We just find out the words separated by spaces or other punctuation mark or other separators, and this is called tokenization. We might also restrict the extraction for nouns. Sometimes adjectives have been considered, verbs might be considered, sometimes the combinations like noun-noun combination, noun-adjective and noun-verb are allowed, but adjective verb or some different combinations are filtered out. So especially if we have a compounded words, so key phrases, then this will come relevant. And also n-grams is the general method to use this multiple words in the same. So there are different approaches, but basically we extract single words from the text after the filtering. And then might apply some this kind of rules, what are accepted and what not. Okay, simple example, BBC homepage, there are these words extracted after the cleaning, and the tokens we will get, we can see that there are some natural words there, but there are still some numbers, some dollar marks and others that are cleaned away. So originally 41 different tokens or words in the page. Then after removing the numbers and punctuation marks and such, we have 35 remaining. And then removing stop words, 29 are the result. 29 candidate words. Okay. After that, stemming and lemmatization, if applied, first we can see stemming. Some of the words are cut to the root for giving query Europe and so on. And you can see, and these are something that we cannot or shouldn't use as such. Lemmatization is also not perfect. It depends on the NLP tool that you apply here. So here notifications happens to be a plural form, not singular. So okay, simple mistake, but nothing is perfect. Here it's also worth to mention that we didn't even go to the Finnish language here. Even if you have tools, they are even less perfect than the tools for English language. Okay, but as a result, 23 different candidate words, and you may see that some words are actually repeating there in the text, so we should later count the frequencies and so on. Okay, so once we have the candidate words, what do we do with them? So there are three different types of features: statistical, structural, and linguistic. So statistical is simply the more often you appear in the text, the more important you are. Structural means that what is your position in the page? Do you have visual emphasis? Are you using title tag or are you used in a link tag? Are you higher font? Have you boldface? And so on. All of these kind of hints give extra information that what word is important and what word is not. And of course the meaning of the word and this position in the sentence and are you noun or verb or whatever, this will give extra information. So first the statistical features, we consider four different types, what we found in literature. And first is the most obvious term frequency. So how many times you appear in the web page. But since we already know that some words are common in every document, so we want to normalize this, and the inverse document frequency is a way to do it. And how it does it is to calculate simply the relative frequency of the word in this document relative to the frequency of the word in all documents. So we need some reference set of documents where we count the overall frequency. And then we take the ratio and then logarithm of that one. So basically it's considered as a probability. And taking a logarithm, minus 2 best logarithm of that one, it's basically the entropy of this probability if you consider from information theoretic point of view. Okay, and then very commonly used TF, IDF is combination of these two. You use the term frequency as a multiplier and multiply the IDF inverse document frequency. So higher is the more times you appear in this document, the higher is your score, and the more you appear in other documents, the lower is your score. So this is quite intuitive approach. Other statistical features might consider also where you appear in the page. Are you in the beginning? Are you at the end? Or you could even consider how separated you are. Does this word appear everywhere in the document or only in one part of the document? So this kind of localized statistics could also be used. Okay, I will give one example about this TF-IDF calculations. So this BBC document example, there were four words that repeated two times, every other only once. So term frequency is pretty simple, 2 and 1 for those. And then the IDF frequency, we did simple Google search and see how many documents Google found with these words. I think these were millions or billions. I don't remember the scale, but these are now the scaled down numbers. And using these as IDF frequencies, we calculate them and then multiply this together and we get the TF-IDF. And what you can see that the most common words, victim, BBC, homepage, accessibility, the first two are specific for this particular news clip, what's something about crime in there, while the homepage and accessibility relate to web pages in general, and as you can see, they are quite common words in all documents. And the less frequent words, clergy, indifference, forgiveness, cruel, church, they were less frequent in any document or all documents in general, so the TF, IDF also became higher. So then already from here we can basically calculate the high score in terms as a victim, clergy, indifference, BBC, forgiveness. So this might be used as a keywords for this document. Okay, I'm not going to what document was it exactly, doesn't sound any pleasant news, but anyway, let's continue. Wikipedia could be used as a source also for the TF-IDF calculations, but I will skip that one and move on to structural features. So basically we analyze the structure of the web page. The DOM tree, DOM tree, was just a tree structure based on the DBAN table and whatever tags they are to find out the organization of the tree structure. But even simpler approaches are just to use the tags themselves. So H1 to H6, the header tags. If a given word is using header tags, okay, it's likely more important. If you are part in the link, like here you can see the link bbc.com, okay, BBC is part of that link, so okay, it gives indication that it might be a good keyword, it's some specific word. Title tags, anchor tags, and meta tags and others. Also capitalization, if you're capitalized in the middle of the sentence, then it might be a special word. Capitalize of all words, okay, that's quite strong emphasis, so these kind of hints can be used. So I don't go to the details of this using the DOM tree in this presentation, but the basic idea is that if a given word appears in many different text nodes in the DOM tree, then it's more important than if all the occurrences are just in one part. Okay, and third features are this linguistic features, so what we can know about the language. Okay, first synonyms and similarity of the words. So the same word can be represented in different ways using synonyms or just something that is similar to each other. So you might need to consider this in the frequency calculations, that not simply to separate, because if you have the same item told in different names, you know, lovely child have many names. But also on the inverse is possible, that if some word is used, if some concept is used with multiple different words in the document, it might not be that important. But if you consistently use the same form or same exact word for certain item, then this consistency is also evidence that it's important word. So it's a both ways. Also named entity, we can use external sources to see that if the word actually is something, is it the organization, is it the country name or such, and immediately this will increase the importance. And the POS as tag, that are you noun and so on, but this we already discussed earlier. So this is example how the POS tag can go even further, that not just noun, but they can be proper noun, singular proper noun, plural, noun singular or mass or whatever. So this already go deeper in the linguistic knowledge and how exactly to use. So I think there are plenty of more to explore in this idea than just using simple that okay, allow nouns and filter out everything else, which is effective but a little bit naive. Anyway, the methods what we talk about are simple enough that we can go to experiments already. So let's see what we can get out of this material now. Okay, so we used 12 different data sets. So there are several magazines. First, 4 English language magazines like Guardian, Herald, Indian and Macworld. And then some Finnish magazines such like Kotiliesi and a few others. 1 German. And then the completely different crowdsourced material MOPSI services that our users have maintained location-based services in the area, especially in Joensuu area, we have different bases. So users have annotated all of these with keywords as well. And since we have the keywords and we have the web page, so we can use this material. So the user annotated keywords are kind of ground truth. And then we can use this to evaluate the methods, how much you can get the similar keywords by the keywords extraction that the users used. In the newspapers, it's a little bit different because these are well maintained by the journals, and all of them has meta words, they have meta tags, all the keywords already in the document. So we have the ground truth there. The downside of this material is that they are quite they are too structured. They are they are a little bit easy for keyword extraction. If we have any random web page from there what we find in internet, it's life is more difficult than that. So in this sense, the MOPSI services are a more challenging example. But it also has a mix of English and Finnish languages. So, okay, let's see. So a little bit about the properties of the web pages. They all can be found in the paper. So most of these magazines has 200 pages from each source. German a little bit less and MOPSI a little bit more than that. Number of keywords per page on the MOPSI has a little bit less, and these journals, they tend to use a little bit more. Okay, so once we have the set of keywords extracted by the algorithm, we want to compare to the ground truth. So we use standard precision and recall measure. So how many of these found keywords, how much we have true positives and how much we have false positives. So what are the correct we found, and then put this relative either to the all positives, so all what we found, so how precise are our results. So, if we get too much garbage or not keywords as an extraction result, then the precision go lower. And recall is that the ground truth keywords, how many of we found them. So we normalize by the found keywords plus all the missed keywords, the false negatives. Okay, so we have 2 numbers, precision and recall standard in this area. And we can summarize this together by F measure by taking the using this equation there. But this doesn't take into account that if we have different forms like study, student, studies, students, different form, So you may not have a match. If you don't have exact match, the precision and recall will get lower. But it does not mean complete failure of the algorithm. So actually, I recommend to use the soft variants instead in the measurement to get it in better context. So we have them both now. Okay, let's see. Okay, first just using the hard measures to see how well the statistical features perform. So we take a simple term frequency as the beginning, and we can see that the results are, according to this, pretty poor. Okay, if we add the stop word removal, you can see that the results become immediately better, still not very good. If we add the other pre-processing steps, the normalizing and such, you can see that, wow, now it starts to work. Okay, not excellently, but from, for example, the Mac world, you can see 0.02, 0.04, and 0.27. So immediately increase to something, some meaningful number. And a little bit surprisingly, the IDF idea didn't provide improvement over that the pre-processing was actually more important. It did improve on the other data sets, but only marginal, and then not all, but only few of them. So this is a little bit questionable, and I think this would require a little bit more studying that how to make it work better, because the idea is quite intuitive, but it didn't seem to contribute to the actual measure. Okay, from here we get our new baseline based on this best statistical features with the TF plus stop word removal and pre-processing. So let's take that our new baseline, and then start to add more features there. So you can see the baseline on the top from the statistical features, and then we start to add. Okay, let's use the title tags, header tags, H1, H2, H3, title tag, URL, bold, italic, emphasizes, and others. And we can see the effect on different datasets. And now if we see the Mac world, we don't actually get any improvement on this. Okay, the header tags gets most improvement from 20 to 24, but after that we try different, they don't improve. And if you consider all of them, it's plus minus zero. The Finnish newspapers, however, you can see there are systematic improvement in all except the taloussanoma that doesn't improve. MOPSI improves from 10 to 16, so here we have clear improvement. And average from 16 to 19 is the improvement. Okay, then let's study the linguistic features, and here we have limitation with the languages. So the first four datasets on the left, four left columns, they are English, and here we can use also these nouns and other no synonyms, named entity ideas, and they do improve. For Mac world, for example, we get up to 25, but then the Finnish and German datasets we can't use it. Or we could use them, but we should have then the resource for these languages. We didn't apply in this study, so here's a questionable how much we could improve those. But for the Macworld, we get from 20 to 21. Others, a little bit less. Maybe the Herald is the most improvement. We get even up to 0.53, which is already a reasonable result, I would say. So from these lessons, we construct new baseline, or not new baseline, but new best combination we called ACI rank. This is just the acronym of the journal where this paper was published. So we use the structural component, all of those features, the first 10 features there, couple of linguistic features, and then the statistical features. We use the Wikipedia TF IDF. Okay. And then we compare with some of the existing methods. So Keybert, Yake, TextRank, CLRank, DRank, HRank, and WebRank. So you can see the summary here in this table. What kind of ideas are used in those methods, and then the results. Okay, first we need to note that WebRank is supervised method. It means that part of the material is used for training and the rest for testing. So it should always perform better than the unsupervised that doesn't have any access to any training material. So, okay, what we see that and on the left side we have the hard measure. This is just the same as in the previous table. On the right side now we have also the soft measure that gives better context at how good the measures really are. And now we have summarized all the news one and news two. And the news one is the English newspaper datasets, and news two are the Finnish newspaper datasets. And one German and one the MOPSI services are here separately. Okay, and we can see that the new best combination performed best, even better than the supervised method WebRank, on average for 0.47 in the soft measure. Except that Germany is a little bit worse, but otherwise it's either the best of the unsupervised method marked here as a blue, or best of overall marked as a red one. Okay, so that's what we got here as a result with these relatively simple ideas for implementing keyword extraction. So let's go to the conclusions. Okay, so first, simple term frequency with stop removal seems to work okay. So we don't need necessarily more than that to make some kind of keyword extraction to work. But the pre-processing turned out to be very important to clean out the text first, that we don't have this garbage numbers or other symbols and such. Then the frequency-based baseline gave result of, okay, with the soft measure 0.37. I would say this quite modest result, and what we didn't show too much on the concrete examples, what kind of other results. But there is lots of to improve here. Not only by the numbers, but the real results. They are useful keywords as a result, but they could be better. And then the new best method, ACI rank, so we get 0.44. So we didn't utilize that much on the other features than the simple term frequency based approach. So I feel there's much more that could be done better here. But anyway, I think this served as an introduction of how keyword extraction of web pages can be done based on these three different types of features. Okay, this talk. Hope you learned something. It was based on this Himatsa PhD thesis works, especially the one paper that in the beginning was mentioned. Also, CL Rank and some other earlier material came from Naitsa Kali and Muhammad Resai's papers, also my previous PhD students. Also, thanks to Florian for providing us the newspaper datasets. Okay, that's all.